organized for understanding, analyzing, and appreciating the nuances and implications of the defense budget in redefining the Indian defense sector. To begin with the proceedings for the day, I invite Shriya Venkoshal, Controller General of Defense Accounts, to deliver the welcome address.
Honorable Chairperson of the Standing Committee on Defense, Ms. General D.C. Khanduri, JVSM, Shri D.K. Mishra, retired Secretary of Defense Finance, distinguished assemblage in the auditorium for the Ministry of Defense, Defense Services, Industry, and my colleagues from the Defense and Arms Department, ladies and gentlemen. India's defense expenditure has been increasing every year in numerical terms. In the past 9 years, that is from 2007-2008, which was the first year of the 11th plan, it has grown at an average rate of 13.6% per annum. While the defense budget has been growing in terms of absolute numbers, it has however been declining as a percentage of the central government expenditure. In some of the developed and neighboring countries, defense expenditure as a percentage of GDP is in the range of 2% to 4% and growing every year. However, India's defense expenditure as a percentage to the GDP is in reverse mode and declining year after year. It was 2.19% in 2009-10 and has come down to 1.78% in 2014-15. Given the compulsions of meeting fiscal and revenue deficit targets and competing demands of other sectors, the defense budget has been under pressure in the last few years. Recommendations of the Finance Commission for devolution of larger share of tax proceeds to the states will further constrain the physical space available to the union government. Despite these trends, defense expenditure still remains the third largest chunk of non-trade expenditure behind interest payments and subsidies. Such large outlays notwithstanding, there is a general perception that non-availability of adequate funding has affected the modernization program, creating serious gaps in military capabilities. Though concerns about resource crunch are genuine, perceptions may have also been formed due to lack of adequate understanding of details and complexities of defense budgeting process. The structure of defense budget is quite complicated and does not lend itself to easy comprehension. Therefore, an objective of today's symposium is to promote understanding of defense budget and its implications for the security of the country. The macro management of India's defense allocations calls for structural review of our dependence on imports for the state of art weapon systems and platforms. We were the world's largest arms importer with 14% global share in 2013. The present government is attempting to change the scenario with its Make in India push that seeks to improve ecosystems capacity to design and manufacture military equipment in the country. A number of steps have already been taken, such as increase in the FDI limit to 49% and setting up of the Technology Development Fund. These measures, along with huge capital investments planned for the modernization of armed forces, will stimulate private sector investment in defense production within the country. We have accordingly planned the second session to deliberate on issues involved in crafting Make in India a reality. Today's symposium, ladies and gentlemen, brings together defense finance professionals, service officers, specialists in security and strategic affairs, and representatives from the defense PSUs and the private sector. We expect that the symposium will demystify the complexity of defense budget by generating a dispassionate discussion on the implications of defense preparedness and government's Make in India program. I am sure the presence of the Honorable Chief Guest, who is Chairman of the Standing Committee on Defense, a distinguished parliamentarian and above all a decorated soldier himself, will set the right tone for deliberations. The distinguished panels that we have put together for the two sessions would bring to bear the knowledge and expertise on today's discussions. I welcome you all and wish you a stimulating and thought-provoking experience. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I now invite on stage Mr. Chandra Mishra, Director, National Academy of Defense and National Air Force, to give us an overview and to deal in depth to highlight the civil war session.
Honorable Chairman, Parliamentary Standing Committee of Defense, dignitaries on the dais, senior officers, invitees, ladies and gentlemen. I shall now present to you the highlights and some analysis of the defense budget 2015-16. The analysis is largely based on the figures of the budget estimates. It does not take into account any change in the allocations made at the revised estimate stage or the overall utilization of the allocated budget. The data used for the presentation is based on the budget document 2015-16 and the previous financial years, and also the report of the Standing Committee on Defense, the last report and the reports prior to that. As you would all know, allocations to the Ministry of Defense are provided under the civil estimates and the defense services estimates. The civil estimates include the demand for MOD civil and demand for defense pensions. The defense services estimates includes a total of 26 demands, first five of which are purely revenue demands, which meet the maintenance and day-to-day expenditure of the ministry. And demand number 28 is a composite capital demand, which provides for the capital budget of all organizations covered under the defense services estimates. So purely in terms of the total number of demands, Ministry of Defense is surpassed only by the Ministry of Finance. Now coming to the salient features of these demands for grants. What we commonly refer to as the defense budget is the net allocation provided to the defense services under the defense services estimates. Till the current financial year, all the allocation provided under the six demand for grants under the defense services estimates were purely non-planned. This year, with the introduction of the Border Roads budget, its inclusion in the MOD civil estimates, a planned component of 450 crores has been included for the first time. The demand for grant for Army includes organizations like NCC, DGQA, Rashtriya Rifles, Military Farms and ECHS. Similarly, the demand for Navy includes the budgetary allocation for Joint Staff. And as discussed earlier, the demand for grant for capital outlay is a common demand covering all organizations under the Defence Services estimate. We begin with the outlay for MOD civil. The revenue allocation under MOD civil has registered an increase of close to 47%. I may mention here that MOD civil provides for the budgetary allocation for a host of organizations like the Coast Guard, JAGDLI, CSD, Defence Accounts Department, Defence Estate Organization, Secretariat Expenditure of the Ministry of Defence. And beginning this year, the allocation for border roads has also been shifted to MOD civil from Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, and an allocation of 3100 crores approximately has been provided for border roads organization there. So coming back to the numbers, revenue has registered an increase of 47%, capital a significant jump of 221%, leading to an overall increase of about 70%. This is largely attributable to the shift of Border Roads Organization budget to MOD civil. Coming to the budget of Coast Guard Organization, which is an important organization covered by the MOD civil allocation, the revenue allocation has registered an increase of about 16%. However, on the capital side, the downward trend that began last year has continued, and there has been a further reduction of 23% over and above the 30% that was witnessed in 2014-15. Overall, therefore, the allocation has dipped by 6%. The defence pensions budget has, however, grown from 51,000 crores to 54,500 crore, which translates into an increase of about 7% as against a 14.5% increase that we saw in the current financial year. However, the share of defence pensions in the total central government pension budget remains at around 62% as it was in 2014-15. We will now look at the allocations under the defence services estimates in some detail. A total of 5.2 lakh crore has been provided under the revenue segment, comprising the five revenue demands that we had discussed initially. This means an increase of 13% in the revenue allocation against 15% that we saw in 2014-15. However, there has been no corresponding increase in the capital allocation, where the B for last year, that is 2014-15, has been maintained at 94,588 crores. And on overall basis, therefore, the increase is 7.74% as against 12.4% that was witnessed in 2014-15. How the allocation impacts the overall revenue capital allocation will be clear from this slide. We now have moved to an overall revenue allocation of 62%, and capital now accounts for 38%. For the first time in the current plan period, capital allocation has dipped below 40%. And if we see from the slide here, it had touched a high of 43% in 2013-14. So we are now down to 38%. Service-wise distribution of the gross allocation, however, is quite different from the overall picture that we just saw. In the case of Army, revenue accounts for 80% of the total allocation, as against the average of 62 that we saw in the previous slide. Navy and Air Force, it is at 39 and 42% respectively. Ordnance factories and defense R&D, revenue budget is 95% of the gross allocation for ordnance factories and 46% for the defence R&D. If we look at the service organisation-wise distribution of the revenue budget and its increase, we will find that the increase has not been uniform. Therefore, Army as an organisation has got an increase of about 11.4%, whereas ECHS, which forms a part of the demand for grant for Army, has grown by another 86% over 32% that it registered last year. Correspondingly, the allocation for military farms and NCC have seen a reduction over the allocation last year, and the increases in the other components are also between 2 to 11%. In the case of other organizations and services, however, the increase is comparable with the increase registered in 2014-15. Share of various categories of expenditure in the revenue budget during 2013-14 and 2014-15 has been quite the same, with pay and allowances accounting for almost 67% of the net revenue allocation, followed by stores and equipments at 18%. The detailed analysis of this kind can be done only after the demand for grants for defence are presented in Parliament. However, going by the overall trend of allocation, this position is unlikely to change significantly. However, based on the allocation available from the documents, a broad distribution of purely paid allowances heads and other heads presents the following picture. In the case of army, purely paid allowances rates account for 69% of the total gross allocation, as against 44% and 47% in the case of navy and air force. In the case of ordnance factories, paid allowances account for 38% of the gross revenue allocation and 38% again for defense army. We now move on to a look at the overall growth in capital budget. After having registered a growth of 9% in 13-14 and 14-15, this year the B for 14-15 is maintained as at 94,588 crores. However, when compared with the RE for 14-15, this translates into an increase of 15% over the revised estimate allocation. A quick look at the service organization-wise increase in the capital budget clearly brings out that there has been a substantial reduction in the outlay for joint staff, ordnance factories, and defense R&D. With a marginal increase for Army and Navy, the position for Air Force is likely to not change very much from the current allocation. However, the position will be clearer once we have a look at the detailed demand for grants. The capital budget is commonly discussed in terms of the share of modernization or the capital acquisition budget and the other than capital acquisition budget. In the year 14-15, capital acquisition budget, which provides for acquisition of new weapons, systems and platforms, accounted for 79% of the total capital allocation as against 85% in the previous financial year. Again, this position will be clearer with the presentation of the demand for grants, but going by the trends available from the budget document, this position will not change very much. So also is the case with the share of services in the total capital acquisition allocation. The previous year, the current financial year, that is 14-15, saw a significant increase in the allocation towards Army from 18% to 28%, and a reduction in the allocation towards Air Force by about 8%, from 50% to 42%. This position and the share of the respective services is likely to remain around the same levels. We will now look at the overall growth of defense expenditure. The D for 15-16, when compared with the RE for 14-15, translates into an increase of 11% in the allocation, which is close to the average annual increase of about 11.5% over these last 15 years.